Good evening. Thank you for coming out. Good to see you all. Let's pray together, shall we? Father God, I thank you for this evening. Lord, I thank you for my brothers and sisters here. Lord, for their faithfulness. And Lord, as I've just been sat there in the quiet before the service, Lord, listening to the music being played and the words going round in my head, once again I thank you, once again I call out your name. Lord, and then I noticed the memorials that are on our wall in our church, the things that I have seen up there and ignored for many years. Lord, I see the names of faithful servants who have gone before us in this place, in this town. And Lord, you've blessed them, you've blessed their ministry, those who have been faithful to the cause, as one of them says. Consistent faithfulness. But Lord, this is our time. They have been and they have gone. And Lord, you have blessed this church since the 1800s and something. Lord, your word has been taught and your word is unchanging. And you are faithful. You are unchanging. Lord, it is the same God that we worship here this evening that they worshipped here hundreds of years ago. Lord, I thank you that we are joined with them, that Lord, maybe even in 100 years from now, there would be people who are still proclaiming the gospel message from this pulpit. And that, Lord, your word would be going out as it has done for so many years. Lord, remind us and lay it on our hearts to know that we're not alone in this. But Lord, while we are here on this earth, while there is breath in our lungs, Lord, we need to be faithful in telling others about you. As these people, these men and women who have gone before us, have proclaimed your gospel faithfully, Lord, I pray that we would not let the side down, that we would not let you down, but Lord, we would willingly serve you and willingly take up our cross and follow you, as we were looking at together this morning. Lord Jesus, speak to us this evening. Challenge us once again from your word. Father, we long to be in fellowship with you. We long for that moment in glory when you will return and call us home. What a wonderful day that will be. Lord, thank you for saving us. Amen. Let's sing a couple of songs together and then I'll read God's word. Okay, so we're following on from this morning. So we're in Matthew chapter 10. And we're reading from Mark. Sorry, well done. Just testing. I wasn't. Mark chapter 10, verse 32 to the end of the chapter, verse 52. And they were on the road going up to Jerusalem. And Jesus was walking ahead of them, and they were amazed. And those who followed were afraid. There's a lot of emotion going on there, isn't there? And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles. And they will mock him, and spit on him, and flog him, and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise." And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" And they said to him, "We are able." And Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." And when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John. And Jesus called them to him and said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. And whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." And they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And Mary rebuked him, telling him to be silent, but he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he's calling you." And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said to him, "Rabbi, let me recover my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. Now, if you keep your Bibles open, because I'm going to ask some questions in a minute. Audience participation. No? You think that's poor? Bad idea. Okay. Well, we've already seen that Mark has structured chapters 8, 9, and 10 around these three prophecies of Jesus about his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And after each prophecy, Jesus teaches on how we are to follow in his footsteps. Okay, so the disciples, sadly, have consistently failed to learn the lessons, at least at this stage. We saw it again this morning, didn't we? They certainly don't see themselves as failures, and we'll get to that in a moment. But now we're entering this third section on Jesus' teaching about his death. But to feel the full impact of this third prophecy, I think it would be helpful to remind us or to compare with the previous two. So it's fairly easy. So you've got chapter 8, verse 31. You've got chapter 9, verse 31. So you can have a look at those. I'll read them. This is chapter 8, verse 31. "And he began to teach them, the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again." Over the page to chapter 9, verse 31. "For he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him. And when he is killed, after 3 days, he will rise." Now, my question to you is, what do they have in common, those two? Just shout it out. What do you see that they have in common? It's not a trick question. Rise again? Yep. He will be killed? Yep. Is there any more similarities? Yeah, delivered over, yeah. He taught them. Yep. Yeah, you're right. It was a teaching opportunity, wasn't it? It's interesting, actually, just reading it just then, I saw something that I hadn't seen previously. And I've studied this quite a lot over the last few weeks. It's interesting that the disciples ask for something, but so does blind Bartimaeus. And Jesus' response each time was, "What do you want me to do for you?" It's interesting, isn't it? It's there in verse 36. It's there again in verse 51. "What do you want me to do for you?" It's the exact same response, at least in the English. Okay, so these two prophecies in chapter 8 and chapter 9, he's going to suffer at the hands of men. He's going to be killed by those men. And in 3 days, he will rise from death. But the third one is ramped up in intensity and in information. Let's put it that way. This is in Mark 10, verse 32 to 34. Jesus says, "And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, 'We are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles, and they will mock him, they will spit on him, they will flog him, and they will kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise again.'" We have more detail, don't we, in this last prophecy that Jesus gives us. Jesus mentions where it's going to happen, in Jerusalem. That's where they're heading. Okay, the city which has been the home of God's people for over 1,000 years at this point. The land promised in Genesis 12. The original call to Abraham involved this geographic place that God would give them, the land of Canaan. And it was promised to Abraham and to his offspring. And Jerusalem became the capital city of that land. The city of Jerusalem was this symbol of united Israel. And it's a city on a hill. So it pops out, if you like. It's not hidden. It's a city on a hill, just like a light on a hill. The Bible calls it the city of God. And Jesus is literally walking into battle. Every step he takes is another step closer to warfare, spiritual warfare for Jesus with Satan. And obviously we know, because we have the rest of Mark, we know that Jesus is victorious. We know that Jesus will defeat Satan at the cross. He will defeat his and our greatest enemy. Now, can you see the significance of this? Jesus was going to be handed over to the unbelieving Gentiles in the very place in which God's presence dwells with his people. And they call their home. And most importantly, they worship the one true God in the temple of Jerusalem, the dwelling place of God. And now, the Son of Man, God's only Son, the one who will be worshipped by all people with a never-ending kingdom, the King of the Jews, would be taken outside of that city, rejected like a discarded criminal, and murdered. And who was going to murder him? Who will he be delivered over to? The chief priests and the scribes. It'll be his own people who will condemn him to death. So there'll be this trial in Jerusalem where he will be condemned to capital punishment. And this rejection will not just be by his own people, but also the unbelieving Gentiles will have a part to play. It says there in verse 33, he will be delivered over to the Gentiles. Okay, this points to the Romans' involvement in Jesus' murder. being crucified on a Roman cross. We also have more detail from Jesus about what his suffering will involve here before his murder. So he's being mocked, he's being spat on, he's going to be flogged. And then we have that very clear statement about his resurrection. So in this third prophecy of Jesus' death, he's very descriptive about his suffering, his murder, where it will happen, how it will happen, who will do it, and that he will die, but in 3 days he will rise from death. Now, if Jesus' disciples at this point were in any doubt about anything that Jesus had prophesied before, about his suffering, about his death, about his resurrection, now it should be very clear, shouldn't it? Jesus has ramped up the intensity here and clarity for the disciples and for us to see. It's not just in Jesus' prophecy of his coming death which has become more clear, though. Also, we see the growing intensity of the lessons that follow these prophecies. After the first prophecy, you can go back to chapter 8, Jesus is transfigured on the mountain, where Jesus uniquely shows three of the disciples that he is the king over an eternal kingdom where Moses and Elijah are. Then they come down from that mountain and they find a demon-possessed boy. Right? And they learn there that there are still powers on earth which mere man cannot overpower by themselves. Okay? And they learn that it's only through the power of Jesus that Satan and his demons can be defeated. Then after the second prophecy, in chapter 9, the disciples still didn't quite understand Jesus and they were afraid to ask him. So instead they argue about who's the greatest. You remember that? Well, they're walking on the road. So Jesus teaches them again another fundamental lesson in following him. It's in chapter 9, verse 35. If anyone would be first, he must be last of all and servant of all. And then Jesus goes on to say that the way that we live should be a humble example, where weak Christians and little children are supported in their faith and led to Jesus with compassion. He teaches that we should deal with our sin in a very radical way, where if our eyes or our hands or our laptop or our car or our money, whatever it might be, causes us to sin, we should throw it away. Because it's better to enter heaven crippled or bearing the scars of battle than to never enter the kingdom at all. And in chapter 10, which we studied together this morning, Jesus teaches us about our relationships and how we glorify God in our marriages. And Jesus gives us that valuable lesson once again about children in verse 14 of chapter 10. He says, "Let the children come to me. Don't hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." And Jesus in this call calls his disciples to radical yet humble self-denial. It's a cross-shaped life, dependent on Jesus, being willing to renounce everything that we have and everything that we hold dear for the sake of Jesus and the gospel. Yet again, Jesus' disciples don't understand. But the story goes on. And one particular law-abiding young man shows up, and he seems, well, he is unwilling to give it all up to follow Jesus because he had great wealth. And he'd replaced God with the love of money. In fact, Jesus says it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter heaven. And the disciples are, by this point, overwhelmed by all these lessons. And so they ask Jesus, then how can anyone enter heaven? And Jesus says in verse 27, "With man it's impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God." So over the past few weeks, that's a very broad summary of what we've looked at. We've learned a lot from Jesus about what it looks like to be his followers. I don't know about you, but to me, it seems, dare I say it, impossible. I don't know how you feel about that, having gone through it again. Does it seem like it's an impossible or an impossibility for us? I think I kind of touched on that this morning, that's the point. With man, it is impossible. That's why we need Jesus. I've certainly failed to live this way almost every day of my life. And the disciples also noticed it. They seem to just ignore these instructions, and it's really important that we don't make that same mistake, isn't it? So how do we live this supernatural life? How do we put Jesus first in everything? Having a humble heart of dependence towards him. Because the disciples haven't understood to this point. And it's really important that we do. So this evening we have some more lessons to go through, more lessons to learn, and we'll see that Jesus turns up the heat even more. But we'll get to those after let's sing another song. Let's pray. Father God, those words are a challenge. I love you more than any other. You alone are my heart's desire. Lord, they're words that we can easily sing to a catchy tune. But Lord, I wonder how much that is true. Father God, we are so dependent upon you for everything that we have. And Lord, even when you graciously give out of your goodness, out of your bounty, Lord, we sometimes cherish the gift more than the giver. Lord, you know what we need. And Lord, you know our desires. You know our hearts. So Lord, I just pray that those words would be real to each and every one of us this week. That Lord, we would truly be able to say that we love you more than any other. That you alone are our heart's desire. Lord, because everything else just falls into place when those words are true. Father God, as we were reminded this morning, I just want to pray again for our marriages. For Lord, the blessing that it is to have a life partner that we do life together with. And Lord, for so many, it's perhaps hard. You know, that Lord, we argue, we say things we perhaps ought not to have said, or things that we don't mean in the heat of a moment. And Lord, I just pray that if there is any brokenness in our marriage, anything that is separating us, that Lord, we would deal with those things. Because Lord Jesus, you came so that there would be no barrier in our relationships. That Lord, all sin is forgiven. And that means we can forgive because you first forgave us. Lord, it means that we can love because you first loved us. Father, help us to have this servant heart and servant mindset in the way that we live with our spouses. That Lord, we would be humble servants. That we would love our spouses more than we love ourselves. That we would put their needs above our own. But Lord, we don't do this so that we would have wonderful marriages and that we can glory in that and make something more out of our marriage than we ought, but Lord, so that you're glorified through our marriages. That Lord, there would be a strength in our unity because Lord, you're at work in our relationships, not just in the intimacy of marriage, but Lord, in the wider context of church life. You're in it all. And Father, where there is division, we pray that you would heal. Lord, that you would reconcile relationships, Father, because brokenness is not what you came to achieve. You're the great physician, and Lord, you can heal the most broken heart. Father, I just pray that we would have that humble desire to love one another, and that, Lord, you would be made glory, that you would, your glory would shine through the way that we love. Lord, we read in your word that we would be known by our love, that the world will know that you are, that we are your disciples because we love each other. Father, we have to have this reconciliation. Lord, we have to have the love between us, that there is something here which is supernatural. Something here among your people, between brothers and sisters, saved by grace, that, Lord, the world cannot see and cannot find anywhere else but in here. Father, I thank you for those people who have recently come into our church and have seen your glory. Lord, they have surrendered their lives and they have turned in faith to believe in you. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for Brett and for Lauren and for Janie. Lord, we pray for them again. Lord, that you would continue to uphold them and strengthen them. As it was only a matter of weeks ago that they were baptized, Father, I just pray that you would bless them, that they would know your presence with them, that, Lord, they would be assured of their salvation. And Father, for us all, some of us who have been in the faith for many years, others perhaps who are new, Lord, I thank you that you meet us where we are. And Father, I pray that you would speak to us, each and every one, this evening, that you would meet us where we are, that, Lord, there would be a word for each and every one. And we pray this in your holy Son's name. Amen. So in our passage tonight, we have an interesting conversation between Jesus and two of his disciples. I call it interesting in inverted commas. This is in verse 35. So they came up to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask you." Now this seems to be a trick question, right? Let me explain what I mean. Nobody agrees to something before they've been asked it. Have you ever made that mistake? Right? Somebody says, can you do me a favor? And you're like, anything. And then they say it, and you're like, why did I say that? Right? It's just dangerous, really. You might be signing up to something you can't possibly achieve, right? But they want Jesus to agree with their request before they've even made the request. Can you see that? But Jesus himself, he doesn't fall for this. Of course he doesn't. He knows their heart. And he asks, "What do you want me to do for you?" Isn't it sad that Jesus knows that their request is going to be for themselves? Have you ever noticed that? What do you want me to do for you? They didn't want to know if Jesus would heal someone for them, somebody that Jesus had just walked past and he missed because he didn't shout, or if they could provide some well-needed food to the poor. But they fall back on their default motivation, number one, the self. Again, showing their failure to grasp the lessons that Jesus has been teaching them. They're a lot like me. Verse 37 says, "And they came to him, they said to him, grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." Now that's quite a request, isn't it? Right? A few weeks ago, we looked at Jesus' definition of greatness, if you remember, and the disciples saw their opportunity for power and authority in Jesus' kingdom. Yeah, and what did they say? This is in chapter 9, verse 35. If anyone would be first, he must be last of all and servant of all. Okay, so if you want to be great in my kingdom, you'll put others before yourself to the extent of servanthood. That's what Jesus says. And this doesn't sound like they've grasped that lesson. They want the most important positions. So they're imagining Jesus on his throne, and you've got James on one side and John on the left, or whatever way around it is, right, on their little thrones. Perfect, they're thinking. And Jesus said to them, verse 38, "You do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink? Or be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" So Jesus responds with this rhetorical question, which highlights their failure to grasp the depth or purpose of who Jesus is and what he came to achieve. Okay, even after the third time Jesus has told them that his purpose is going to Jerusalem and what will happen to him there, they still haven't understood. And Jesus replies with, "Are you able to drink the same cup?" But they take it as a real question, and they say to him, it seems with confidence, "We're able." Yeah. Jesus compares his suffering with two parallel images here, and he talks of a cup and he talks of a baptism. Let's look at that baptism of immersion, I should add. Let's look at those two individually. So they both describe Jesus' suffering. Okay, this cup imagery is used in the Old Testament to specifically highlight divine judgment. Jeremiah 25, verses 15 to 16 is one of those examples. It says, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, said to me, take from my hand this cup of the wine of wrath, and make all the nations to whom I send you drink it. They shall drink and stagger and be crazed because of the sword that I am sending among them." So in using this imagery, Jesus is again pointing to the fact that he will receive upon himself the wrath of God as a sacrifice for sin, as the sacrifice for sin. And Jesus says, "Are you able to drink that cup?" And the same is true of the baptism imagery. So baptism is being submerged in water, literally overwhelmed by water. And again, in the Old Testament, suffering is sometimes described as water. Okay, so for example, Isaiah 43, verse 2. "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you." In other words, you're going to go through a trial, but I'm going to be with you. They're not going to overwhelm you. Now, we also know that both of these, the cup and baptism, symbolize Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. We had it last Sunday morning, I think. We drank of the cup, the Lord's Supper, and we had baptisms recently. For those people who are new to the faith and they identify with Jesus, so they go into the water, they're buried with him, and they rise again to newness of life. It's a symbolic image of what Jesus has done internally for them. So both of these things, they symbolize Christ's sacrificial death on our behalf. And Jesus says, "Are you able to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" And they say to him, "We're able." Now, Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized." And James and John hear Jesus' words as a call to greater commitment. So they express their willingness to suffer and die for him. So although their request for the best seats in the kingdom of God was at best misguided, let's put it that way, they show courage in their willingness to answer Jesus' question here, isn't it? That Jesus has got this call on their life to give up their lives for him. And although they cannot drink the exact same cup that Jesus will drink, they will certainly suffer. And so, in their own way, they will experience the cup and the baptism by following Jesus. So, verse 40, "But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." Jesus says that it's God who appoints those positions in his kingdom. It's not by our merit, but by humble submission to God that positions are given out in his kingdom. Verse 41 says, "And when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John." Now the word indignant there in the Greek means selfish anger. Now you can read into that, selfish anger, what it could mean. And I say could because it's possible it doesn't mean this. What it could imply is that the others were annoyed because they wanted those seats. That's what it could imply. It's possible that they were annoyed because James and John beat them to it in asking for the best seats. Jesus finds himself again having to repeatedly teach the same lesson. "If you want to be first in my kingdom, you must take the place of a servant." Verse 42, "And Jesus called them to him and said to them, 'You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you.'" We know this, don't we? Right? We can all think of, we all have authorities over us. Whether it's a boss, or a council, or a government, or a company, whatever. We all have different people. Ultimately, we all live in England, so we all have that authority of the government over us. Many people have authority. Some of you have authority. And some people, sadly, exercise that authority without ever thinking about how it affects others. But what does Jesus say? Verse 43, "But it shall not be so among you." We're to be different. We are to be different. It's an important lesson for us all to learn and to remember. If you hold a position of power and authority, don't lord it over people. But instead, as Jesus said, "Whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus seems to sort of extend that servanthood now into slavery. You see that? He's almost, changed it a bit. It's not just a servant, it's a slave. Slave of all. Now, do you know the difference between a slave and a servant? A servant has some rights. Some servants may even be paid. A slave has no rights, often taken against their will. That's the difference. Now, the truth is, if we all have this servant heart, we will do nothing but serve and allow our greatness to be shaped by Jesus' definition of greatness and not by our own. And these things are hard for us to put into practice, aren't they? They're hard for us to put into practice. But as humans, we're very clever at finding solutions to problems. We are. We really are. Yeah, surely there must be an easier way for us to live this Christian life. There must be an easier way. I'll give you an example of human ingenuity. Okay, now before the war, the Mara Zoo in Gaza painted their donkeys black and white because they couldn't purchase any zebras. So they just painted donkeys black and white. Right? Surely we can come up with something like that. One bus company in China, after receiving a load of complaints, placed a large bowl of water over the driver's head so that he would not drive round corners too quickly. Because if he did, he'd get wet. People come up with ideas, right? Maybe we could put our heads together and come up with an easier way of doing this Christian life. Maybe the answer is to shut ourselves away from the world. That's what we should do. Become monks or nuns. I don't know how you feel about that. Goes against what I said this morning about marriage, doesn't it? But that doesn't work, because Jesus says to his father in his high priestly prayer in John 17, verse 15, he says, "I'm not asking that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one." So we're not to remove ourselves from the world. We're to live in it under God's protection, empowered by the Holy Spirit. So we can't do that. We can't turn away from the world in order to conquer our sins and look more like Christ. So what can we do? To live like Jesus is described here is hard. It's hard. Okay, how often do you see or hear of a CEO in London with a six-figure salary helping the cleaner in his office at the end of the day? I've never heard of a story like that. Or offering them the keys to their Ferrari so that they can avoid the busy underground trains and get home quicker with a smile on their face. See, in these past three chapters, we've got Jesus saying, come as a dependent child, become the slave of all, destroy any pride you might have, cut off your hand if it causes you to sin, don't make wealth your idol, willingly suffer to the point of death for Jesus, give everything you have to the poor, and trust Jesus for everything instead, pursue greatness, but greatness that looks like servanthood or even slavery. How do we do it? How do we do it? Well, thankfully, Jesus has been spelling it out for us this whole time. He has been spelling out this forever solution to our problem. And it's in the words of Mark chapter 10, verse 27. With man, it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible with God. And what is God's plan to redeem us, to rescue us, to save us? Jesus said he came to verse 45 of chapter 10 to give his life as a ransom for many. Substitution is the answer. Substitution is the answer. Verse 45 begins with Jesus as the example that we're to follow. For even the Son of Man came For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And it ends with the perfect solution when we fail, which we do. And that is that Jesus came to give his life as a ransom for many. See, even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. God came to this earth putting on flesh. God, in all his fullness, entered into human history, became one of us, experienced our limitations. But it wasn't always that way, was it, for Jesus? It wasn't always that way. You see, before Jesus came to this earth as a baby in Bethlehem, Jesus was outside of time. He created time so that we have a structure and an order to life, and we get a break when we sleep. But he was outside of time. A day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day. So in God's perspective, in Jesus' perspective, last week he created the world. Right? He's able to hear and intimately know every single person on this planet, of which there are 8.04 billion. Mind blown yet? If we all prayed to him at the same time, he'd be able to give his full attention to every single person. We did that last Sunday evening here. I remember Trevor saying, it's amazing that God can hear every single one of us at the same time. It is. That's the God that we serve. That's the God that we love. Jesus is worshipped in heaven by the angels. He's king over every king that has ever lived. He is Lord over every Lord that has ever lived and will ever live. He's designed every planet and every solar system. He sustains every planet, every plant, every creature. He decides when a sparrow falls to the ground and he knows about it. Everything is under his control. And yet even he came to earth not to be served, but to serve. We have no power of our own to grasp hold of. We really don't. Because that power and authority that we do have, that you do have, that I have, is only given to us by God anyway. Whatever authority we do have, it's like a passing breath, isn't it? Yet we are given that authority by God, and how we use it can either be for his glory or it can be for our glory. Those are really the two options. See, Jesus, instead of lording it over us, he chose to serve. He chose to die in our place so that we don't have to face the just and righteous wrath of God. Amen, right? Thank you, Jesus. Verse 46, and they came to Jericho. Now, the city of Jericho is famous in the Bible, isn't it? I think you all know the story of Jericho. You'll recall it had some big walls which fell down without anybody touching them after some marching. And the name Jericho, interestingly, means smell. If you're expecting some insightful reason for me mentioning that, I can't give it to you. I just thought it was an interesting fact. You're welcome. So as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. So Jericho was packed full of people heading towards Jerusalem for Passover. And they all wanted to see and hear Jesus. So he's accompanied by this huge crowd at this time. But despite the crowd, Mark focuses in on one blind man who sat beside the road. Verse 47. And when he heard, that's when Bartimaeus heard, that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. Blind beggars don't have the right to disturb such well-known and respected teachers. Okay, so people just tell him to shut up. And he cries out all the more. I love this. Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and he said, call him. And they called the blind man saying, take heart, get up, he's calling you. I love the way Jesus isn't influenced by anyone other than the Holy Spirit and his Heavenly Father. Aren't you? Jesus is demonstrating this humble, compassionate, selfless heart of servanthood here. And again, Jesus doesn't come to be served by the crowd. He comes to serve the poor, the blind, and the helpless. Now, can you imagine being Bartimaeus on this day? What's all this commotion about? He's wondering. There's more people, perhaps, than normal walking past. I don't know. Why are there so many people all of a sudden? Who are they all following? And someone answers his question, it's Jesus of Nazareth. He's like, I've heard about him. He's the son of David. He's done amazing things. He's going to do even more amazing things. And I want a chance to meet him too. And it didn't matter how many people were trying to tell him to be quiet. He just called out all the more. Jesus, can you hear me, Jesus? I believe you're the Messiah, Jesus. How excited would he have been when Jesus says, call him? There are probably people on earth that you'd be really excited to meet, right? I love that question. I think it's quite insightful. Anybody who has lived or is still alive that you would like to meet, have a meal with, ask questions, get to know who that person would be. I remember when I met Daniel Bedingfield. Some of you might know who he was. He was a Christian singer, but then he turned pop a few years ago now. But I was at Spring Harvest in Skegness, and he was performing there, and so I met Daniel Bedingfield. Anyway, Jules and I were with two of my cousins, Ben and Daniel, and I asked Daniel Bedingfield for a photo with Jules and my two cousins. Okay, he was in a big rush. He was running, I don't know why, probably to get away from me. But he didn't really have time for us. So I quickly went to take the photo. I had an old camera, not phones, that they weren't mobile phones with cameras on that were any decent. So I quickly went to take a picture of Jules and my two cousins with him. And this was before the invention of the selfie. You know, when you get yourself in the picture, the forward-facing camera. This is just one of the old ones, right? And I took the picture all excitedly, and I looked at the camera, at the little screen, and I realized that my lens had been completely zoomed in. Okay? So all I had was the chests of Jules, Daniel Bedingfield, and my two cousins. You could just about make out the chin of my cousin Daniel. And that was it. And I was like, oh, Daniel, do you mind if I take another one? I was zoomed in, it didn't come out. And he said to me, you took a photo, don't lie. And then he ran off. I once met Jenson Button, Formula One driver in London, in Trafalgar Square in 2005. And he pretty much completely ignored me. Completely ignored me. Barely even acknowledged my existence. Now, sometimes when we meet that person who we really respect and we really admire, they can let us down, right? Because they're not the person that we thought they would be or thought they might be. Okay, now you could say, well, they are important people, Joe. You're just some bloke from Stowmarket, right? They can't stop every single time some fan wants a picture. And I get that, I understand that. You know, they've got places to be, money to make. And no doubt you'd be right, okay? But think about it this way. There hasn't ever been a more important person than Jesus Christ to have ever stepped foot on the face of this planet, ever. And he is. He stopped. He stopped for a beggar. What an example Jesus is to us. He had time for Bartimaeus. And he has time for you. And he has time for me. He'll never get bored of you. Ever. Talking about marriages, sometimes we get bored of each other. Right? That's why people have kids, isn't it? Distraction. That was a joke. You know, Jesus will never get bored of you. You can't overwhelm Jesus with your questions or by wanting to spend more time with him. He loves to be with you. He loves your attention. Even though you might be too much for some people, you cannot ever be too much for Jesus. He loves you more than anyone else ever could. It's amazing. Verse 50, and throwing off his cloak, Bartimaeus sprung up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? There's that question again. That's the second time today, like I said, that Jesus has asked that question. How would you answer it? How would you answer it? What do you want me to do for you? The answer to that question, I think, reveals a lot about us, probably what's important to us. What do you want me to do for you? And blind Bartimaeus said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. He wanted to see. He longed to see. And Jesus said to him, go your way, your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed Jesus on the way. Jesus gave Bartimaeus his sight. And who was the first person that he saw? Jesus. How awesome is that? His eyes were opened and he saw Jesus. Believed in Jesus and followed Jesus all the way to Jerusalem, where Jesus was going to die for him. Mark draws a stark contrast here with a blind man and the spiritual blindness of the religious leaders who were opposed to Jesus and will plot, or are if not already plotting, his death when he gets to Jerusalem. And in Mark chapter 2, we read that Jesus didn't come for the self-righteous, but he came for sinners. He came for those who recognize their need of him. You know, that's a question that's so often asked of Christians. Well, Christians are all hypocrites. You know, you all think that you're perfect. No, we don't. There isn't a Christian on this planet, if they're genuinely a Christian, who hasn't admitted their guilt before the Lord. How can we be hypocrites? I know my failures. That's why I'm a Christian. That's the reason I'm a Christian. Because I have no hope in and of myself. I need Jesus. He came for those who recognized their need of him. The prideful, the self-righteous, the religious leaders, they rejected the kingdom. And so they received blind eyes. They received deaf ears. The disciples only want the prideful throne of their own. While blind Bartimaeus regains his sight by crying out to God for mercy. Which camp are you in? Which camp am I in? We too have to come to Jesus as sinners saved by grace alone. Jesus says those words to us too. Your faith has made you well. Your faith has washed you clean. How grateful we should be to Jesus for stopping to care about me. For taking this journey to Jerusalem. To suffer and to die in my place. I've lost count over these three chapters that we've looked at over the past month or so. The number of times the disciples have received an invaluable lesson from Jesus and seemingly either ignored it or forgotten it or not taken grasp of it. And we can see the disciples' mistakes clearly because I can sit down with the Bible and I can read it. I would dread to think if somebody was to write my life story and somebody sit down and study that too. Certainly be worse than this. But we often don't see our own, do we? We often don't see our own mistakes. And I've been going through, like I said, these past three chapters in quite depth. And it's almost annoying to me how many times the disciples are deaf to Jesus' words. When I just think, when are they going to get it? And I know when they're going to get it. So it's a bit of an empty thing because I know that they're going to get it at the cross and then they're going to get it when they receive the Holy Spirit. And then that transforms their lives, doesn't it? then they go on and they live this out in amazing ways, amazing ways. But I think, what will it take for them to start humbly serving instead of shoving kids out of the way or worrying about their hungry bellies or pride-filled positions in glory? And then I thought about myself. I've been studying this at great lengths. I've spent hours, days, studying the last three chapters of Mark. And how much have I changed? How much have I applied of what Jesus has been saying? I've gotten annoyed at the disciples' hardness of heart and rejection of Jesus' teaching, and yet have I done the exact same thing? How much have you been challenged by your own way of living during this mini-series in Mark? Where have you failed to change? Sadly, we too are in many ways just like these disciples. We need spiritual sight, don't we? And a fresh dependence upon God. And if you're anything like me, you'll realize just how much you need Jesus to come into my life, to come into your life, to awaken us to the things of Him, to move us, to fill us with His Spirit, and to change us for His glory. Amen. We'll sing along. Heavenly Father, I thank You for sending Your Son to the cross. Lord, I thank You for Your love for us, that You sent Your Son. And Lord Jesus, I thank You for walking from Jericho to Jerusalem for me. Lord Jesus, I thank You that on the way You stopped for a blind beggar called Bartimaeus. That, Lord, 2,000 years later, we are still marveling at the things that You did, the way that You loved, the humble servant heart of all. Lord Jesus, help us to reflect You more to the world around us who so desperately need You. Lord, that we too would have Your heart at work within us. Lord, bless us this week, we pray. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Amen. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, Your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back.